Hodder & Stoughton Limited presents Admiral by Julian Stockwin, read by John Telfer. In Memoriam, Christian Rodsker, 1945 to 2024. It is with great sadness that we learned of actor Christian Rodsker's passing in March 2024. On behalf of Julian Stockwin and Hodder & Stoughton, we would like to thank Christian for his work and sterling narration of the Thomas Kydd series, a partnership of over 20 years, as well as countless other audiobooks during his career. A skilled and talented actor and narrator, we couldn't have wished for a better person to bring the world of Thomas Kydd to life for listeners around the world to enjoy. We are grateful to John Telfer for assuming the mantle and narrating Admiral, Book 27 in the Thomas Kydd series, and we hope you enjoy listening. A note from the author. For almost the entire series, Christian has been the voice of my Thomas Kydd tales, bringing a very special atmosphere to the audio experience. Although I am deeply saddened that he could not narrate the last book, it does give me some comfort to know that he and John Telfer were friends. And I like to think Christian would approve that he has picked up the baton. If it had not been for the English, I should have been Emperor of the East. But wherever there's water to float a ship, we're sure to find them in our way. Napoleon Bonaparte, St. Helena. Those far distant, storm-beaten ships upon which the Grand Army never looked stood between it and dominion of the world. Alfred Thayer Mahon, naval strategist. Chapter 1. 1814, HMS Thunderer, the English Channel.
Our pennants! Maneuver well executed!
The signal lieutenant of HMS Thunderer tried to conceal his pride as he relayed this to his captain, standing legs abrace on the quarterdeck of the venerable ship of the line.
Very good. Do acquaint Lieutenant Ambrose of my approbation of his conduct, acknowledged Sir Thomas Kydd.
It had been intelligent and timely work at the staysail by his second lieutenant's forecastle division taking up on the new tack. In the fluky calms, the rest of the squadron had missed stays. Admiral Cotton had been insistent that his command should exercise regularly, which Kydd put down to a need to reduce boredom as much as operational necessity. His own seamanship after long service in a fighting frigate was unmatched, in no small part due to his origins as a sailor before the mast. One by one, the other ships took the wind. Kydd had sympathy for the captain of the ponderous flagship Culloden, trying to keep with the sleeker third rates. Still, it was a measure of the man that the Admiral had publicly acknowledged Thunderer's achievement. The breeze gave a playful lift, and the seas chuckled under the 74's forefoot as the line took up on the fresh tack, and a new signal leapt up Culloden's mizzen halyards.
Our pennant, sir,
and
proceed in execution of previous orders.
It was a welcome hoist, requiring Thunderer to make for port, to spend a week refitting after the gales and general unpleasantness in the channel during the autumn. And shore leave was to be granted for the seamen after their long blockade duty. Kydd wasn't going to let them off so easily, however, and once out of sight of the squadron, the decks thrilled to the heavy rumble of gun trucks. One side of the 3-ton, 32-pounders competed against the other in the hard exercise of drill, the mock serving of the monster creatures, and running them out before hauling in for a reload. There was a chance for the losers to regain the honours. Kydd had carefully hoarded his allowance of powder and shot in order to put in some live firing, always appreciated by the crew, who enjoyed the smoke and concussion after the tedium of long days of peace and order. The target was an old painting scow, fitted with an inverted V-mast between which a worn red blanket made a serviceable sail and firing mark. It was streamed astern, bobbing jauntily while Thunderer wheeled around at a half mile's range. Kydd wanted to see the action on the gun deck. He knew that his presence would indicate serious interest in the proceedings, and he clattered down the ladders to the gloom of the gun spaces. Martin, the lieutenant of the lower gun deck, stiffened. He was as much under the eye as the gun crews. "Honored to have you with us, sir," he said carefully. "Times from you?"
"No. Do know, sir, I'm not here, and you'll have your timings from the quarterdeck."
His first lieutenant, Roscoe, would be up there, conning the ship as if in a battle to rake and harry the hapless punt. Kydd would watch from the sidelines. As the preparatory orders rapped out, he quietly surveyed the row of guns. With the fleet-wide hunger for men, there were not enough to man both sides fully, so to keep an element of competition, every second gun was manned. It gave them more room to perform the deadly ballet that was play at the guns, and at the same time scope for speed, which would stay with them when fighting a single but full side of guns. The din of bellowing gun captains, growling quarter gunners, and peremptory officers' calls died away. The crews were tense and ready. Then Kydd noticed a thick-set, broad-shouldered figure standing still and watchful in the center of the deck under the gratings. Gunner's mate Stirk, a warrior of legend, and one to whom Kydd owed so much of his formative early years as a young seaman. He'd personally trained the gun captains, and his critical eye would judge them far more harshly than Kydd. Nervous glances at the figure were more numerous than those towards their noble captain.
"For exercise, larboard, 5 rounds.
The relayed command was piped at the hatchway, and Martin rapped the order that had the gun crews snap to alert. As a drill only, there would be no firing, but the side of the violently heaving 3-ton iron beasts was no place for the faint of heart. 5 cycles of loading, running out, and firing were exercised as Stirk stood impassive. This drill was commonplace, at most evening quarters, conducted as routine. A flick of his finger indicated that the starboardlings were winners. They could now laze and watch the larboardlings sweat in a round to see if they could claw back a victory. Then there was a lull, which Kydd knew was Roscoe bringing Thunderer around to bear on the target, seeming a far smaller mark through the gun port than from the open deck. It gave time for the crews to gird for action. Gun pouches of spare flints, quill tubes for taking the spark from the gun lock to the main charge, slow match gently glowing in the match tub, and training tackle ranged free.
"Open fire, starboard, in 5 minutes,"
squeaked a midshipman messenger at the hatchway. Ready loaded, the massive pieces were run out in a deep martial rumbling, their muzzles questing over the restless seas. Kydd squatted, squinting through a gun port at the far-off red blob. This would not be broadsides, which were used only at close quarters to terrify an enemy at the height of an action. Instead, each gun would fire alone, so that fall of shot and therefore accuracy could be made out. Stirk moved behind and in line with the muzzle of the first gun. He kept clear to allow the gun captain room, but had the same sight picture. There was work with the crow to lay the gun more precisely. Roscoe knew to keep the ship unwaveringly on course, and more at the coin until the gun captain, back curved over the gun to see down its length, was satisfied. The man paused a heartbeat to have the lazy heave of the ship lower the muzzle on target. Then his hand on the lanyard to the gun lock whipped back. With an ear-splitting bellow and instant smother of gun smoke, the black monster slammed back, its shot taking seconds to reach out and send up a leisurely white plume, 50 yards short, but well in line. Stirk padded over behind the gun captain. Words were passed, and the man nodded vigorously. The gunner's mate resumed his position, and even from this distance, Kydd could make out the dark glitter of Stirk's eyes. He was satisfied with the performance. It wasn't that the gun had missed. It hadn't. A real opponent would loom many times larger, and the present shot would most certainly have taken it well in the center of its bulk. It was more that the first ball from this gun had been so effective from the start. If the rest of the gun deck was like that, then any sudden close action would be lethal to the enemy. No more than 2 rounds per gun were permissible in the miserly allowance, but they made the most of it. With the setting sun came the crash and roar of guns. Then it was rest, the welcome benison of grog and the evening meal. Chapter 2. At the other end of the ship, the wardroom had invited Kydd to their dinner. Together they toasted the taut man-of-war in which they found themselves and happily joined in the old catches and glees so revered over the years. I'm here or there a jolly dog, at land or sea I'm all agog, to fight or kiss or touch the grog, for I'm a jovial midshipman, a smart young midshipman, a very little midshipman. Sung by Ambrose, the mature second lieutenant, it brought roars of laughter. The more nostalgic third lieutenant, Martin, offered, "Aboard of my true love's ship I'll go, and brave each blowing gale. I'll splice, I'll tack, I'll reef, I'll row, and haul with him the sail. In jacket blue and trousers too, with him I'll cruise afar. There shall not be a smarter tar aboard a man of war." Kydd sighed and relaxed with his brandy, regarding his officers with affection. Such warm, enjoyable evenings were what it was to be an officer at sea in these long wars. The French were not abroad, and it was becoming increasingly unlikely that they would be caught up in a grand fleet action in the near future. But if they were, Thunderer was ready. His eye caught Craddock's. His confidential secretary never drank more than guarded sips, but was an agreeable messmate.
"Dear fellow," he called above the happy din, "do tip us something of the evening."
Craddock raised a glass in acknowledgement. The man had witnessed hideous scenes in the Adriatic, but service in Thunderer had brought him through to the other side.
"I'd rather I had the sea cant to add to your merriment, but I don't. Should Mr. Shakespeare serve, I should be glad to oblige." "Do carry on, old trout."
Craddock stood and imperiously declaimed,
"In cradle of the rude imperious surge, and in the visitation of the winds, who take the ruffian billows by the top, curling their monstrous heads and hanging them with deafening clamour in the slippery clouds, that with the hurly death itself awakes. Canst thou, O partial sleep, give thy repose to the wet sea-boy in an hour so rude?"
To his evident surprise, it was rapturously received, if somewhat glassy-eyed by some.
"Henry the Fourth, part two," he added apologetically. "The third act or so, as I remember."
The moment was saved by Kydd, who expressed a pressing desire to unburden himself of a somewhat saltier ditty. And the evening progressed to the early hours. Chapter 3. Approaches to Plymouth Harbour, Devon.
"Great mew in sight, nor'east 7 miles, sir."
In hours, Kydd would be back in the inexpressibly dear surroundings of Knoll Manor and would know the love of Persephone, his wife. He levered himself out of his cot, letting Beenar, his valet, set up for his morning shave. A daylight sighting was good navigation by the quarterdeck, and there, further inland, beyond the triangular rearing of the island, was all he held dear. And he would be in time for the evening repast. A little later, the big man-o'-war's anchor plunged into the mud of Corsand Bay, and, for all intents and purposes, Thunderer had made her way home. Dutifully, Kydd took boat for Mount Wise to make his number with Garland, the port admiral.
"Weren't expecting you, Kydd. Weary of North Sea pastures."
The man looked tired and more than a little hunted, and Kydd wondered what impossible task had been laid on him. As it may be, sir, Admiral Cotton did send me here for the fettling. It had been thoughtful of his commander to specify Plymouth instead of the nearer Portsmouth dockyard, making casual excuse of a current build-up of work there.
I'll get it underway with the master attendant, then. You'll need victualling, powder, shot?
It's been quiet in our part, sir. No need, really. The Admiral looked up gravely.
You'll have heard that Boney has got himself an army of size again, of course. How he does it, God knows. But what we can be sure of is that he'll be on the march again presently, and we'll all be pitched into a new wrangle.
And we'll serve him in the same way, Kydd said stoutly. Garland gave a thin smile.
If you saw things from where I'm sitting, you might have your apprehensions, I believe. Know that 3/4 of our fleet is all the 7 seas over, preserving our empire. And I'm to find the means to keep them there.
He slumped.
And muster hulls enough to face up to Boney here if he gets uppity.
A long war, sir. A devil of a long war.
You'd pay no mind to me, Kydd. You make the most of your liberty ashore. I heard you now have a youngling in tow.
Chapter 4. Knowl Manor, Devon. The evening sun gilded the leaves of the trees, achingly poignant, before the autumnal winds turned them bare. Kydd was at the heights of happiness, however, for he and Persephone had young Francis toddling round and round the lawn as dinner was being prepared.
It's all so ironic, Kydd reflected.
What is, dearest?
That here I am, as contented with life as any man alive, with my true love and mine own estate, and a modest sum to keep us in our aged years.
So you deserve it, my dear.
He stopped and looked at her fondly.
Have you ever considered that, wicked as it is, if it were not for this endless war, I would still be of the common folk? No hobnob with a king, prize money, the respect of the people, 1,000 men to do my bidding. I owe it all, Seth, to a bloody war.
You'd succeed whatever you chose in life, Thomas. Your country needs you at this time. You've answered, and that's all there is to it.
She glanced fondly at their son. He was visibly tiring, and they retired inside. The next day, Kydd decided to ride with Persephone to the snug Ivy Bridge alehouse, the London Inn, to meet his neighbours and tenants in that pleasant setting. The ostler came out to take their horses, and they entered the dark, brassy interior to scattered greetings. But there was a distinct pall in the air.
They've had a dismal harvest this year, the 2nd in a row,
Persephone whispered as they took up their favoured, high-backed bench near the fire. Kydd felt for them, early to rise, toil and care every day of their lives, and in the last act a failure for all their efforts.
Not Sir Dimber the yields this year, Daniel,
Kydd called to a shrunken man in a worn smock, nursing his beer.
Shall you join me in a pot?
He was rewarded with a mumbled account of storm-beaten wheat fields and a stubborn murrain in the cows before others came to add their tales of grief. One or two tried to say something about Kidd's war, but the gulf between this ageless, rustic existence and the majestic heave and menace of the ocean was too great. The gloom was almost palpable, and in Kidd's heightened mood of delight at his return home, it was dispiriting. He caught Persephone's eye, and they took their leave. They picked their way homeward in silence, the clopping of the horses' hooves loud in the afternoon stillness. After a space, Persephone said lightly,
Thomas, my dear, should you oblige me in a small matter, I'd be so grateful.
Her horse whickered, as if adding its encouragement.
Why, of course, my darling. What's it to be? The orangery or London for the season?
Not so arduous at all, my love.
Well?
My dear, have you ever wondered what life holds in store for you?
She said softly, avoiding his eyes.
Often, Kydd laughed. A mariner in anything of a blow has his views, you must believe.
I meant more our future, my dearest.
The tone had become more troubled, and Kydd felt a wash of misgiving.
Have you anything as vexes you, Seth? He asked.
Thomas, there's a lady in the village I'd like you to meet.
If you wish it.
She's of a certain reputation.
At Kid's puzzled look, she went on carefully.
Well known as being out of the ordinary, fey, as you might say.
As claims to see into the future. At sea, he'd encountered lower deck troublemakers who'd unsettled the crew as they darkly foresaw certain shipmates being swept overboard or suffering some other dire fate, or disclosing who would not survive a bloody conclusion in an action against the enemy.
Persephone went on. She knew that Eliza Mortimer would not see her 18th birthday and forecast that George Broadley would lose his farm before the end of the year. Not only that, but...
No.
Thomas, Mrs. Garson is a respectable widow who has the gift of prescience. It wouldn't do you harm to hear what she has to say now, would it?
I don't believe in such catblash, Seth.
You did say you'd oblige me in this small thing, she said, lifting her chin.
It would not be an easy matter for Kydd to dismiss. Chapter 5. The little cottage was set back from others, and as soon as they set foot inside, Kydd was oppressed by its gloom and the faded furnishings of another age. Mrs. Garson was a short but pert individual of some years, but with uncomfortably sharp eyes. They were shown into a small front drawing room with a diminutive bay window.
"And what can I do for you, my dears?"
I met Mrs. Bampton in the market the other day, Persephone said, and she recommended your services in the matter of advice in respect of the future.
Both women ignored Kid's snort.
I see. Well, please to sit. I won't be a moment.
She returned with a single candle in an elaborate oriental holder, which she placed carefully on the table between them. It was scented with a vaguely eastern aroma that reminded Kydd of the harem of Pasha Jezzer, the butcher, in Acre. Moving shadows were cast all about the dimness of the room.
May I know to whom I'm speaking?
That it was Captain Sir Thomas Kydd and his lady did not disconcert her, and she sat primly, hands in her lap.
This is upon a question concerning a decision of sorts, perhaps.
Persephone glanced at Kydd, then replied steadily,
Not as, who should say, Mrs. Garson. I'm rather more interested in my husband's prospects.
Kydd was startled.
She wanted to know his prospects?
She knew well enough their holdings in consols at 3%, and...
I see. Then I find it will be necessary to know more of the gentleman. Do present your right hand, Sir Thomas.
This is ridiculous, Seth. How can she...
Sir Thomas, you know nothing of my profession, yet object to its practice. It is, may I point out, the result of many years' study and experience, and owes nothing either to witchcraft or to the diabolical. Kindly oblige me.
Do as she asks of you, Thomas, I beg, Persephone muttered.
Reluctantly, he obeyed. The seer cradled his hand and peered closely by the light of the candle, then looked up sharply.
A very interesting study, most interesting. This is not the hand of the common sort, yet neither that of the gentle-born.
She studied it further and leaned back.
I see much pain. A rope. No, many together. I do not know what this can mean.
She ended wonderingly. Kydd felt the creeping unease of the unknown invade his soul.
How could she know
that the knight of the realm before her had once been flogged with a cat o' nine tails on the deck of a man o' war?
Never mind that, Mrs. Garson. What does the future hold for him? Will he live to see his grandchildren, for instance?
Persephone cut in, her voice both brittle and troubled. Then Kydd understood. She was trying to find out if he would survive Bonaparte's murderous war. The woman darted an appraising look at Kydd and said flatly,
In these times, my lady, the threads of existence are not easy to trace.
The stress and vexations of war do distort the decrees of fate that are laid down for an individual and are hard to realize by mere mortals.
She paused and then said in a businesslike tone,
I believe we must look to the cards. I favor the pique variety in this delicate matter. Have you any objection? No? Then I will ask when it was Sir Thomas received his existence.
When I...
He was born in 1773, the month early January. Capricorn, thank you.
She began slowly and carefully shuffling the cards, laying them down one by one in front of her, peering intently at them as she did so.
Yes, as I feared, a sad moil of strife and striving.
She looked up directly at Kydd, and in the single candlelight her expression was chillingly bleak.
Your profession is one of hazard, I see. There have been occasions when your continuance on this earthly plane has been despaired of, and I must advise that I find these will not cease in any wise.
Can you not?
He heard a catch in Persephone's voice, but in the face of such, could think of nothing to say.
I will try.
To his alarm, she sunk back with a moan, her eyes rolling up out of sight.
The line of time I can see is not long, not long, and my vision is obscured. Oh, so much din and furore on either hand, and it is difficult to distinguish, to understand. Ah, I see now a road which we comprehend as the highway of life.
She mumbled something, then collecting herself said more loudly,
I must tell you, it does not extend for so far.
Persephone gave a small cry, her hands to her lips.
For all is veiled in an evil fog that swirls to and fro in a vexing manner.
She swayed, her look of concentration fierce as she strove to see more clearly.
It is causing me distress to penetrate further, but for your sake, I shall try to do so.
In the absolute stillness, she contorted and writhed, then gasped.
The fog lifts just for a moment, and there ahead I perceive that the highway does not end. I see it forks. There are two roads now that go in their two directions. This, then, is a point in your existing where a deciding must be made in a great matter in which you must not fail. What is it? Do tell, please.
Persephone was now openly wringing her hands.
I cannot go on. The pains, the agitation it is causing me.
She said faintly, her features suddenly old.
I must cease and withdraw before.
The session was at an end. Chapter 6. Outskirts of Bautzen, Germany. A movement caught Adjutant Commandant Moreau's eye. A slight dip in the landscape, shadowed in the failing light, was strewn with bodies after a particularly vicious clash at arms. The stink of squalid deaths and reek of gun smoke hung in the chill of dusk, redolent of the piteous desolation and waste of life that was war. His horse picked its way nervously through the corpses as he returned to Napoleon Bonaparte's campaign headquarters. He had made a foray into the forward lines to verify the condition of the bridge over the Hauptspree, which had so lately been in enemy hands. Movement again. This time he caught sight of several ragged individuals who were robbing the corpses, and his mind erupted into a blazing rage. He wrenched the horse's head around and urged it over, hurling abuse at the scattering figures. But one crouched low, yanking at a dead officer's waistcoat. Moreau tore out his heavy service pistol and blindly loosed off a shot. The pilferer dropped onto his victim, writhing spasmodically. The colonel of engineers, who was with Moreau, said nothing, falling in behind as they rode on. Lanterns were flickering into light in the distance towards Bautzen, but nowhere was as bright as the complex of tents and carriages that was Napoleon Bonaparte's Grand Quartier Général Impérial,
The Emperor would probably be at his desk, in the larger tent at the center, and it would not take Morrow long to make his report. But the tent was alive with noise and laughter, filled with the glitter and splendor of officers of every high rank. Champagne in hand, they were loudly extolling their part in the recent victories that had made Bonaparte's name feared again in the land. It had been a remarkable recovery. From the months since the calamitous retreat from Moscow, swift and heroic measures had been taken that now saw the army at something like its original immensity, more than 500,000 under arms, their numbers growing rapidly as younger conscripts joined the ranks. In the artillery parks, at least 1,000 guns awaited action, and with Napoleon Bonaparte in personal command, it seemed the grand retreat was over. In only the last weeks, the situation in Germany had been transformed. A brilliant engagement resulted in the capture of Dresden, followed by the ejection of the Allies from Hamburg, a major strategical coup. Then it had been hard-fought battles, at first Lützen, then lately Bautzen, that had seen the courageous but bull-headed Blücher and his Prussian army of Silesia fall back in disarray. It could be only a matter of time before the Emperor's troops made a strike against the Allied horde that would leave the roads to Berlin, Prague, and Warsaw, even to the Oder, open to reconquest. The noisy gathering quietened, and eyes turned to the swirl of activity at the entrance. The Emperor. In his old-fashioned white breeches, field grey and plain tunic with a single star, he was the center of attention, moving slowly while still dictating to a secretary and affecting not to notice the press of officers. Processing to the center of the capacious tent, he stopped and looked around in surprise.
"Mes braves," he murmured with affection. "My loyal and ever victorious band of warriors. We who have stood by our country in its gravest adversity and now gather to rejoice in success at arms. I salute you. I salute you all." He neatly relieved a nearby officer of his champagne and theatrically toasted them, bowing politely at the roared response. "And I bring you news that shall set all true hearts of France a-beating." He now had absolute silence. "The enemy are seeking terms for an immediate peace, an armistice, and I'm minded to oblige them." Gasps of astonishment met his words, for surely it couldn't be so. Arrayed against them were three monarchs at the head of their armies, Tsar Alexander of Russia, Francis of Austria, and Frederick William of Prussia, the mighty hordes that followed bent on revenge. That they'd been brought to this pass was incredible.
"A measure of the fear and respect that is now commanded by the French Empire, I believe, and a dramatic portent to our destiny," Bonaparte added. His tone was not triumphant or exalted, but one of certain conviction, acceptance of logical inevitability. Moreau shook his head as though to clear it. He, of all on the Imperial General Staff, knew the wider situation as Adjutant Commandant of the Corps des Ingénieurs Géographes, an engineer responsible for the vital strategic service of providing the staff with the maps and enemy assessments so necessary for war planning. By any metric, the enemy had little reason to lay down their arms, if only for a period. With their lines of supply safeguarded by an invincible Royal Navy, and the vast masses of Russian peasants endlessly streaming out to join the horde, it would appear the end was inevitable, were it not for one thing. This was not a host acting as one under the direction of a single mind. The Allies were fractious, bickering, opinionated, and divided among competing leaders, and they'd been outmaneuvered by the greatest military genius that ever was. He'd leave the head scratching until later. For now, with rising spirits, Morrow joined in the general mood of jubilation.
Chapter 7. The armistice was granted, at first merely 3 days, then some weeks and months into a blustery autumn. The Allies seemed to have recoiled to lick their wounds, and all the while the Imperial headquarters was in a ferment of activity. Bonaparte set to, preparing energetically for his grand advance, securing adequate stores, powder, clothing, making proclamations to the regiments, organizing reviews and awards, martial display, pomp.
"I'd wish for space to repose, I swear,"
Colonel Engineer Amier said quietly, his eyes closing. The process of reproducing artillery ranging diagrams for the regiments was not moving ahead at the speed his chief Moreau would be happy with.
"What's that, Gerard?"
Amier hadn't known that Moreau was standing behind him, distractedly leafing through yet more demands from Grand Marshal Berthier and his general staff.
Amier opened his eyes and surveyed the pile of diagrams. "As I fear, I'm drowning in paper is all, sir."
Throwing down his documents, Moreau gave a gusty sigh.
"Shall we not flee to my quarters for stolen refreshment, do you think?"
The cognac went down well, and the two friends visibly loosened.
"To more grand blows in the old style," Amier breezed.
"The old style," Moreau agreed cautiously. But he knew things that were being deliberately concealed from the common herd. Bonaparte's judgment had been in question in more than a few instances. Now he seemed not to realize that his old empire of men and resources was no longer his to order about at whim, as it had been in the glory days of conquest. There was also his apparent obliviousness to the huge shortfall in horses after the colossal losses of the Russian campaign. This was bad enough in battle. No matter how brilliant the action, it was Bonaparte's practice to throw overwhelming cavalry at the losing enemy to turn victory into a crushing rout amid great slaughter. But in the engagements at both Lützen and Bautzen, the Prussians had been able to withdraw in good order to fight another day. And cavalry was needed to range across the vast frontage of the facing enemy, to bring back regular reports of their forces. Without this knowledge, every strategic decision risked a blunder in the darkness of ignorance. In addition to the loudly trumpeted triumphs, there had been, within days, three lost battles fought by the Emperor's less gifted subordinates, one at the cost of an Imperial Eagle with its commanding general, all for want of intelligence.
"As long as the temper of the rank and file is up to the call," Amier responded, not catching Moreau's eye. "Quite, old fellow. You know the figures as well as I, but ours is not to question the means."
To conjure an army on such a scale, it had been necessary to conscript near children and the long retired. The veterans that Bonaparte had led to stand proudly astride Europe were now few, and famous regiments were formidable in name only. Amier was not downhearted.
"But, sir, it secures us the numbers. If we count those standing ready in garrisons as well, we can field close to a full million under arms this very day."
Moreau sighed, but remained silent at this further indication of Bonaparte's fading powers. Those garrisons, relics of the time when the whole continent was subjected to the French Empire, were under orders to remain in their fortresses. They were intended to act as impassable threats to the progress of the Allies' armies. Instead, they'd been contemptuously bypassed and isolated by the advancing troops, and now lay, starving and forlorn, far in their rear.
It was a sad misjudgment that effectively halved Bonaparte's numbers.
Yet, as had been shown so recently, given a straight fight, the Emperor could still bring cunning and energy to the fray to produce an undoubted victory. And, Moreau reasoned, his master's overall strategy should result in success in the longer term. After all, in the past, he'd beaten each and every opponent that now faced them. He knew their strengths and weaknesses, and his strategy was simple. Given their absurd desire to act independently, Bonaparte would take on each separately and inflict defeat by bringing to bear overwhelming numbers under a single command. A stony-faced orderly interrupted the pair with dispatches. From the expression he wore, Moreau knew it brought bad news and quickly tucked the pack into his waistcoat to read later.
"Probably another misstep by Marshal Ney facing the Prussians."
I mislike that we're to sit in idleness while Germany lies at our feet, Amier said, helping himself from a dish of sweetmeats.
You dare to question our emperor, sir?
Moreau said in mock horror.
Oh, well, I thought that time to return to work, I believe, Moreau said abruptly.
In a private corner, he turned to the dispatches. It wasn't just bad news, but a series of merciless hammer blows. First, the Austrians had broken the terms of their alliance with Bonaparte. They had moved to be counted among the Allies in coalition against them, a wily maneuver by Metternich, their Machiavellian chancellor. It would now take fiendish efforts to counter the torrent of fresh troops pouring into the field. The rest was worse. Encouraged by this shameless act, the Allies had unilaterally broken the armistice, and the rest of the dispatch set out specifics of a bold line of advance by Blücher out of Silesia, while the other columns were apparently on the move in the direction of Leipzig. Moreau crumpled the paper. Damn their lack of horses and reliable reconnaissance. His dispatch was only a copy, of course, and by now Bonaparte would be pacing to and fro, then make some lightning decision that would send army divisions at speed to confront the threat. This was where the master strategist would be in his element. On the featureless plains of central Germany, the two titanic forces would confront, then fall to the brutal killing and destruction of one another. An unimaginable spectacle of at least a million souls locked in lethal combat in a single stretch of countryside. And they had to be supplied. Meals brought to them each day, powder and shot, clothing and shelter, hospitals and surgeons. There was no end to the immense demand, which in turn required skilled staff. It was complicated in that different elements of the military formations would be marching this way and that to head off a thrust here, take advantage of a situation there. If the movements of the commander on the spot were not relayed back at once to headquarters, the vital supplies would end up at the wrong destination. And it was Moreau and his department who maintained the battlefield plot. They would be responsible for ensuring its accuracy and timeliness in this and Bonaparte's sweeping strokes of strategy. And if that was not enough, as an engineer, his duty was to ensure river crossings by bridge or pontoon. Hundreds of thousands would tramp over them in advance or retreat, or even over marshes that required passage by heavy guns. Failure could not be entertained.
Chapter 8. The vast Allied armies, maneuvering only by forced route marches for days at a time, began to coalesce in their positioning. And it became ominously clear that Leipzig might not be the intended objective.
Give me that,
Bonaparte grated at a sweating messenger bearing news of the latest developments in the field.
Moreau,
he barked.
Sir?
Your assessments are pas bon du tout, you rogue. What am I to make of this, that Field Marshal Schwarzenberg is heading for Dresden, not Leipzig?
His hair was tousled and thinning, the sunken eyes gleaming with a demoniac energy.
Sire, my sources, such as they are, do indicate Leipzig as the objective with rat shit. This is naught but a clumsy ruse. It's Dresden thereafter, and there I shall make it a hell on earth for the beggars.
The town was at least 70 miles south of Leipzig, some days' march, rendering unrealistic any notion of recovering forces sent there should there be a determined assault on Leipzig. This would be one of Bonaparte's famous gambles.
I'll take the bulk of the army with me, Bonaparte continued. Should amount to 250,000. Place them both sides of the Elbe before Dresden.
He didn't raise his head from the staff map as Moreau carefully pointed out the risk to Leipzig, throwing out,
Don't worry, old crow. I have a wicked surprise in mind for Blücher.
The campaign headquarters rapidly struck camp, the practiced result of countless occasions, and 250,000 men set out to tramp the long miles ahead. Moreau had several matters to attend to and delayed leaving. He was about to depart when a flustered aide hurried up with urgent intelligence. It didn't take him long to grasp its grave implications. Captured dispatches had revealed that the Allies had not wasted the time of the armistice. They had come together in an agreement, the Drakenberg plan, that struck at the very heart of Bonaparte's grand strategy. They would decline battle with the general no matter how favorable the odds, for fear of being overmatched by his military genius. Only when they could bring to bear a concentration of force of crushing proportions would there be a confrontation. This way, the old strategy of defeating the Allies severally, one by one, would not be possible. Their individual formations would fade and vanish as Bonaparte appeared before them, leaving him to lead his huge and increasingly exhausted army seeking battle this way and that across the country in forced marches. The combined strength of the three monarchs at the heads of their armies would shortly be greater than anything Bonaparte could command. Could he reverse their fortunes by a daring coup de main? Chapter 9. The Outskirts of Dresden. As Moreau and his little band of staff engineers approached the old town, he had his answer. In the fields and small settlements, the French soldiers lay in extreme weariness, but in a state of jubilation. Just 2 days previously, before the Drakenberg plan could come to fruition, Bonaparte had won a victory of impressive proportions. Dresden was safe and in his hands. But there was a deadly postscript.
"An intelligence, sir, that I think you will not welcome," Moreau said, handing over his carefully scripted interpretation of what he had learned from the captured dispatches. The Emperor grunted, closing his eyes.
"Tell me."
Moreau laid out the essentials. Like a volcano, Bonaparte erupted.
"The miserable worms! Those devious barbarian swine!"
He leapt from his chair and began pacing furiously.
"They seek to rob me of my victory. While I'm still in the field, they'll learn they can never beat us."
Moreau waited patiently. Bonaparte had every reason to vent his rage, but it did nothing for the situation. He left abruptly, but Moreau guessed where he'd gone. Increasingly, the great man was given to bouts of ill-tempered sulking and was now out of touch in his quarters. Amier approached apprehensively, clutching a fistful of papers.
"Such a tantrum in the hour of victory?"
Wearily, Moreau told him. Amier shook his head in despair.
"See these?"
he said in a low voice, holding up the pack of maps and scribbled instructions.
"It tells Marshal Oudinot to take a full 120,000 and lay siege to Berlin. Sir, he's dividing his forces in the face of a combined enemy. He's never done that before."
So that was the surprise he'd prepared for Blücher. And he'd been caught out. In theory, a swift hook around to take Schwarzenberg in the rear was a battle winner, but without cavalry reconnaissance to locate the opposition, it was madness.
What shall we do, do you think?"
The Emperor could not be disturbed, and in the absence of direction, headquarters staff work petered out in despair. Then news came of a disastrous deterioration in the position. Lacking warnings of Prussians in hiding, General MacDonald and a whole division of Bonaparte's army had been defeated in the most comprehensive way. In 1 day, 13,000 had been killed or drowned, 20,000 taken prisoner, and 2 eagles, regimental pennons, lost. It had been the worst of conditions. In pelting rain, muskets and other guns were useless, bringing on a vicious hand-to-hand struggle by bayonet, sword, and lance that ended with the French routed and driven into the river to drown. On the other wing, Marshal Vandamme's command was trapped and annihilated, he himself suffering ignominious capture. The losses were great, but in the face of the 500,000-strong numbers in Bonaparte's army, they were not catastrophic, but for one thing. Raging across the country to bring the Allies to battle was exhausting and ruining the fitness of an army that badly needed rest. Also, the soldiers were suffering from hunger and increasing cold. Bonaparte roused himself and decreed a retreat to the Elbe, his field forces to lie beyond the river barrier. It was too late. The position had already been turned, and there was nothing for it but to fall back on Leipzig, where he'd set up winter quarters outside the town. But the Allies did not rest, and as autumn laid its chill miasmas over the ground, they probed and harried, thrust and vanished. It became clear that Dresden had been a distraction, and the main target was Leipzig. And within reasonable marching distance, all Allied columns were converging there. Bonaparte would have his fight, in the old style, and on the grandest of scales. Chapter 10. It couldn't be hidden from Moreau, who had the full state of affairs as far as Bonaparte and his headquarters staff could know it. Within days, 1.5 million men would be locked in battle, and Moreau had no illusion that this would be anything but a fight to the death. The first news was confused. Rapid traverse and feints, skillful disentangling and clumsy deceptions at places the maps had only as meaningless names. Then, as different parts of the Allied armies combined, battles swelled and climaxed, the ground disfigured for miles with corpses, tramped over by tired troops unable to rest, to eat, to sleep. It was becoming near impossible for Moreau to account for enemy deployments, or the sudden movements of artillery and the menacing eruption of whole brigades of cavalry on lines of marching soldiers. As the conflict thickened into a crucial struggle for battlefield supremacy, Bonaparte often rode out to the front, much as in the old style of Wagram and Marengo. Showing himself, he lashed his men on with taunts and threats, encouraging and exhorting by turns. At one point, so close was he to the fighting that a howitzer shell killed his horse under him, but undeterred he pressed forward. Another legend born. Moreau saw what it was costing him. Returning, his face would be mask-like, pale and expressionless. The levrée, a collation of the latest situation reports in book form, would be listlessly flicked over, and then depression would deepen, turning into hours of lethargy, galling for those wanting a decision. There was no slackening of the brutal fighting, often stretching into the night and the following day in an endless punishing contest. But it couldn't last. Battle of the order of millions was unsustainable with the resources Bonaparte had. He was attempting vainly by rapid march and countermarch to meet the Allied thrusts coming at him from every direction. Much of his army was now within the walls of Leipzig, with Schwarzenberg's legions of many nations within plain sight. With long land-bound supply lines threatened and the need to preserve his army in the numbers he would need for any fight back, there was only one course left: to fall back beyond the substantial river Elster that bounded Leipzig and regroup. Summoned, Moreau saw how Bonaparte's cheeks sagged. His corpulence appeared more marked, and his movements were slow.
"There's no alternative," the Emperor said. "Get your men together. Find every bridge over the Elster and destroy it. Save one, of course."
The retreat would be orderly, the great army crossing and then the last bridge blown up, the pursuers left on the far bank, unable to follow.
"So, be started, sir."
The procedure was well known, and Moreau quickly had wagons loaded with the gear needed, even if items such as powder casks were difficult to source. That night, under escort, he set out for the north. It was a journey from the brotherhood of officers to a hell on earth. The encampments they passed held the exhausted rump of Bonaparte's 500,000 in fearful condition. They had received no bread or rations for days, and with the constant marching to and fro, their shoes were worn to ribbons. Bare feet bled in the freezing mud. With provisions and clothing lost to confusion and the enemy, greatcoats and warmth were denied them. It was essential for Moreau to secure their crossing and provide precious rest and security. Trying to ignore the stench and misery, he urged his engineers on, and one by one the bridges were blown while the enemy was kept at bay by heroic feats of sacrifice. Blücher, launched a furious assault on the defenders. The climax was near. It was critical that the final remaining lifeline from the far bank, the last bridge over the Elster, was kept clear for what would be a retreat behind the fast-flowing waters. Moreau took charge at the near side of the bridge. He posted a strong, outward-facing defensive line on each side, three deep, directing between them the retreating columns in an orderly fashion across the bridge to blessed refuge. That rearguard would then be released to make its own way to safety. What had to come next kept him on the last yards of soil on the east bank, which the French would hold. At the exact moment that the remainder of the rearguard was securely on its way, but before the first attackers set foot on the bridge, it had to be blown up. Not before, or the last defenders would be trapped, and not after, or the attackers could get to the charges and defuse them. Moreau was responsible for the laying of charges and the timing. And for the deed itself, he needed a man of cool head and utmost courage. Sergeant Didier Corbineau, the graying old campaigner, had been with Moreau since the glory days of Austerlitz and Friedland. A miner and rock splitter, he had a pair of sons proudly in the ranks. Moreau would verify the charge location, climbing awkwardly among the stone piers above the rapidly surging river to inspect, peering up at the casks daisy-chained around the column heads, ensuring that the match length to each was equal to bring about a simultaneous detonation. It was not enough to bring down a width of roadway. It wouldn't take long to construct temporary bridging over it. A major section, complete with the massive stone pillars, had to be reduced to rubble on the riverbed.
"I'll be with you, sir,"
the old soldier rumbled as the final act was explained. Moreau would remain to judge the moment. On his signal, Corbineau would touch match to fuse, and the crossing would be no more. In the confusion, Moreau would take boat for the opposite bank, bringing the sergeant with him. The first of the army corps came up and began pouring across, a scrambling welter of men and equipment, their horse-drawn guns abandoned. They were in all manner of colourful uniforms reflecting the many nations and tribes that Bonaparte's net of alliances had provided. In stabs of anxiety, Moreau raised his head and sighted the distant figure of Corbineau, loyally staring his way, waiting for the crucial signal. As if in realisation of what was happening, the enemy changed tactics, recklessly storming the massing French. But even after 3 days fighting, they were a formidable army, and with ferocious discipline they faced back and blazed away at their tormentors with everything they had. Moreau crouched down. Sleeting bullets found flesh to tear and men to slay on all sides as they fought to funnel into the constriction of the bridge. He hunkered lower. Then he was struck by a sickening thought. Corbineau was enduring the same. What if he was brought down, leaving none to obey his signal? He raised his head and saw the sergeant's loyal figure, upright and unflinching in the lethal hail, steadfast in the face of death, patiently awaiting his fateful signal. Frantically, Moreau gestured to him to get down, take some sort of cover, but the man seemed not to notice. He rose to his feet, ignoring the whoomph of bullets around him, and with exaggerated flattening movements, repeated the signal. At last, there was a brief wave of acknowledgement, and Corbineau disappeared from view. Moreau dropped prone again, watching their precious army pushing forward to the vital bridge. There were tens of thousands to cross, and it would take time before... In a cataclysmic split second, the world turned demented, his brain telling him of a vast, deadly explosion. And then he realized what it meant. The bridge had been blown, and in the same moment he understood why. His staunch and devoted sergeant had mistaken his movement to flatten himself as a signal to carry out his duty, and the reality pierced his soul. It was a blinding catastrophe. Some had been torn to pieces by the explosion. Screams and shrieks came from the press of men at the river's edge as they saw their escape cut off and were inevitably driven to their deaths in the pit that had opened up before them. Morrow could only watch in speechless horror as men fell to their doom, their heavy breastplates and equipment causing them to drown in minutes. Others were cut down by Cossacks who had ridden into the seething, leaderless mass of desperate men, laying about them mercilessly with their heavy sabers. Pulling himself together, Morrow looked frantically for his waiting boat, but couldn't see it in the hopeless confusion. Eventually, he spotted it, bottom up, carried away by the current. Only those who made it to the far bank would live to see another day. It was a sauve-qui-peut. No officer could make himself heard in the uproar and confusion. Jostled and struck by panicked men desperate for escape, Morrow looked about helplessly. A sudden blow sent him slithering down the bank into the writhing turmoil of drowning men and horses. Threshing around in the icy water at the edge of reason, he grappled for a floating corpse, then let it go to seize an empty cask and was carried along, clear of the nightmare. Chapter 11.
Pay no mind to it, old crow. War is war and things happen.
His voice was muffled, but there was no mistaking the Emperor's commiseration as he sat by the fire, head in his hands. In that moment, Morrow could have worshipped him. He had just been informed that his great army had been half destroyed, routed in a single stroke, and the man who had caused it was standing before him. There was little that could be done.
Leipzig was now abandoned, and Dresden must inevitably capitulate later. There was nothing for it but to yield the battlefield with its mountain of dead and fall back. But to where?
The army was shrunken and in disorder, the countryside alive with uprisings, and the combined Allied host was closing in remorselessly. There was no alternative but to retire to the Rhine, to the very bounds of the sacred soil of France, and concede Germany to Blücher and the enemy. It was inconceivable. They were no longer to be legions of conquest, simply defenders of the homeland. At the traditional crossing point of Mainz, they took up positions along the great river and settled into quarters for winter.
À votre santé, mon brave,
Morrow said, lifting his glass. It was a very acceptable Bourgogne, a bittersweet reminder that even while they'd fallen back on France, they were now able to indulge in the choice produce of their native country. Amier gave a wry smile.
Whatever the future may bring.
You have doubts?
Of winning against the horde at the gate? As long as Bonaparte stays at the helm? No, only that it's going to be a devil of a toil uphill for a donkey's age yet.
You don't yet know what is planned for the spring campaign.
Will we have the men?
I would think by then we will.
The Allies have stopped at the Rhine, reluctant to face us on our own lands, I'd fancy.
Amier looked up, his expression troubled.
It won't last, of course.
It will if his Nibs plays his usual card.
Oh?
Goes for a peace for as long as he can while we regenerate.
Ah, then we have to say it's now in the hands of the diplomats. God help us.
Chapter 12. Brooks's, London.
The post, if you please, Kydd asked after he'd settled in a high-winged chair and secured his whiskey. The club steward obliged, and Kydd opened at the continental news of the day. Although he was now a senior captain, his interest in the endless, shrill talk of allegedly vital clashes between unimaginably large armies left him bored and restless. But he felt it was his duty to keep up with the news.
Good to see you back, old fellow.
Kydd lowered his newspaper in something like relief and saw it was Malone, a mild and unassuming but exceedingly wealthy Kent landowner.
Oh, Frederick, draw up a pew. A snorter or something warming?
Just passing by.
He pulled over a chair and looked at Kydd quizzically.
Wondering if the view of this damnable war is clearer from a quarterdeck by any chance?
Not from where my stout barkie's been spending her days.
A plump, familiar figure crossed to them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.